Man, we're having a great time celebrating this day that the Lord has made, rejoicing and being glad in it. You know, one of our children here at the church was so excited about Jesus' resurrection that he made an Easter card and gave it to me. And it's got to be one of the best and unique cards I've ever received. And I want you to see what was given to me. Look at this card right here. Isn't it awesome? He is risen! Glory to Jesus! Well, you know, no matter how you spell it, Jesus rose from the dead. Amen. I heard this story a while back about something that happened to the Pope while he was riding in his limousine. He kept telling his chauffeur to go faster. Faster, my son. Faster, my son. And the chauffeur said, look, I'm going as fast as the law allows. And the Pope said, please, my son, go faster. And so he went a little faster, but he says, I'm going as fast as the road allows. Please, my son, go faster. And finally, the Pope said, my son, please pull over. And so he pulled over, and the Pope got in the front seat, chauffeur got behind in the back seat, and the Pope took off 80 miles, 90 miles, 100 miles an hour. Pretty soon, you see those lights in the back, flashing lights. And so the Pope, you know, obediently pulled over. The patrolman came up and asked him for his ID, but he quickly recognized who he'd pulled over. He pulled over the Pope. So the patrolman wisely called his supervisor, and he said, well, what's the problem? And he says, well, I don't know about this person. He says, well, is he more important than the city councilman? Yeah. Is he more important than the mayor? Uh-huh. Is he more important than the governor? Yes. Is he more important than the president? Yes. Well, who is he? And the policeman replied, I don't know, but whoever he is, the Pope's the chauffeur. You know, today we're celebrating the resurrection of the Lord Jesus Christ, the most important person who's ever walked the planet. Amen. I want us to turn to the book of Acts, chapter 17. Acts, chapter 17. One time the apostle Paul was in the city of Athens preaching to the intellectuals and philosophers of his day on Mars Hill, up where the temples were. And in Athens, we're told in verse 18, Paul had a debate, and I'm kind of mixing the New American and the New Living Translation here as the story unfolds. He had a debate with some of the Epicurean and Stoic philosophers. When he told them about Jesus and his resurrection, they said, what's this babbler trying to say with these strange ideas he's picked up? Verse 19. And they took him and they brought him to the Areopagus, saying, may we know what this new teaching is which you're proclaiming? For you are bringing some strange things to our ears. So we want to know what these things mean. Little parenthesis here in verse 21. Now all the Athenians and strangers visiting there used to spend their time in nothing other than telling or hearing something new. They always wanted to spend their time looking at new ideas. Verse 23, the Apostle Paul says, as I was walking along, I saw your many shrines on one of your altars, and it had this inscription on it. To an unknown God. You see, the Greeks wanted to honor all the gods. They wanted to make sure we didn't miss any. And so they even put one up to, well, we don't know who we might be, but we want to make sure that we cover all the bases. So to the unknown God. And so Paul takes this as a great diving board to go into his message. And he says, I was walking along, I saw your many shrines. One of them had this inscription, to an unknown God. He says, this God whom you worship without knowing is the one I'm telling you about. Therefore, what you've worshipped in ignorance, this I proclaim to you. Verse 24, the God who made the world and all things in it, since he is the Lord of heaven and earth, does not dwell in temples made with hands. And you can probably see his gestures. All these beautiful temples are there. We still have a few in the Acropolis there in Greece. Verse 30, God overlooked people's ignorance about these things in earlier times, But now he commands everyone everywhere to repent of their sins and turn to him. For he has set a day for judging the world with justice by the man he has appointed. And he proved to everyone who this is by raising him from the dead. Who's the man he's talking about? Jesus. Now pay particular attention to what happens next. Verse 32. When they heard Paul speak about the resurrection of the dead, some mocked, it says. Some laughed in contempt. But others said, we want to hear more about this later. And that ended Paul's discussion with them. But some, we're told, joined him and became believers. People then, as they do now, respond to the good news of Jesus Christ and his resurrection in one of three ways. First of all, some people responded to the message of Jesus' death and resurrection this way. Number one, you can write it down, they derided it. Verse 32 says, now, when they heard of the resurrection of the dead, some began to sneer. Well, even 2,000 years ago, there were skeptics and people who scoffed at the gospel. They belittled the message. When the philosophers heard the word resurrection, they burst out laughing and mocked Paul. They viewed Jesus' resurrection with contempt. And as I said, many people do that today. But there have always been people who have mocked the work of God and his plan for salvation through the history of the world. I can't help but think about Noah. God told Noah, Noah, I want you to take your family. Oh, Noah's wife's name, little known. Her name is Joan. Joan of Arc. Oh, well. Write that down. So he says, Noah, I want you to take your family and I want you to build an ark so that you'll be safe when the judgment comes. And so Noah, 120 years he worked on that ark. People did live longer in those days. We know that. For 120 years he preached and he built. And finally his family went into the ark and the door was shut. And then what began to happen? Began to rain. He'd preach and he says, look, you've got to believe me. Judgment is coming. It's going to rain. And when it started to rain, people began to be believers. We're told that the fountains of the deep opened up and the earth was flooded. And that's why you find fossilized seashells on the very tops of mountains. But nobody was deriding and ridiculing when the rain started falling. And I'm sure Noah was deluged with apologies. Oh, well, every service, that one goes right by. I'm not going to do it again. The first Christians preached Jesus Christ rose from the dead. They preached that message, think about it, among the very people who could have easily refuted it simply by producing the body of Jesus. All they had to do was produce his body, and that would have silenced the whole deal. But the tomb was vacant and the grave clothes empty. Paul Athanas of the University of Erlangen, Germany, states, listen, the resurrection could not have been maintained in Jerusalem for a single day, for a single hour, if the emptiness of the tomb had not been established as a fact for all concerned. Many people saw the resurrected Christ. They looked on his face. They touched him, they heard his voice, they ate with him. He really, really was alive. In fact, at one time, we're told that 500 people appeared to him. Now think about it. If you're like Paul and you're preaching this, you could actually say, well, I can get you in touch with somebody who saw Jesus alive. This isn't just a story. Or people could say, it never happened and we can prove it. Nobody could do that. We also see the evidence of the disciples' changed lives. Though they fled and even denied Jesus at the time of his arrest, only John, we know, stood at the foot of the cross with Jesus. 50 days later, they are boldly proclaiming Jesus is alive, Jesus is the Savior, and they're doing it in front of the very people who crucified him and condemned him and could do the same thing to them. There was this miraculous change in their attitudes and their behavior. That is another testimony to the very fact that Jesus did indeed rise from the dead, and they knew it because they'd seen him. And then who can argue with the testimony of people like us around the world who have been changed by Jesus Christ? Amen? Our testimony matters as well. In other words, we know that Jesus is alive not only because of the historical and biblical evidence, but because of the evidence that he has miraculously touched us. The evidence is overwhelming. World-renowned scholar, Greek scholar, Brooke Westcott said, "Taking all the evidence together, it is not too much to say that there is no single historical event better or more variously supported than the resurrection of Christ." The majority of people, maybe you're one of them, don't know that Jesus repeatedly and in various contexts prophesied that he would indeed die, be delivered to the religious leaders. They would condemn him, he would die, he would be buried, and 3 days later, he would rise from the dead. At least 4 times, Jesus declared that, he prophesied that. A lot of people don't know that. The Bible faithfully records these statements. The book of Matthew records one of these times in Matthew 16, 21. It says, "From then on, Jesus began to tell his disciples plainly," note the plainly, "that he had to go to Jerusalem, and he told them that what would happen to him there. He would suffer at the hands of the religious leaders, the leading priests, teachers of the religious law. He would be killed, and he would be raised the 3rd day. Jesus clearly, plainly said, "I'm going to die, I'm going to be buried, I'm going to raise from the dead the 3rd day. Another time Jesus declared in John 10, 17 and 18, I love this, listen to what he says, "I sacrifice my life so that I may take it back again. No one can take my life from me. I sacrifice it voluntarily. For I have the authority to lay it down, and when I want to, also to take it up again." Listen to this. You know, I see these, I see a lot of these movies and videos about, you know, the final days of Jesus' life, and, you know, they're well done. And you see him, you know, in the judgment hall, you see him being mocked and beaten, and you see Jesus carrying the cross. And it kind of looks to me like Pilate and crew and Roman soldiers and the jeering mob and religious leaders are kind of in control of this whole situation. And they're forcing Jesus, whipping him on with the cross. Listen, gang, Jesus said, "They're not in control of my life. I voluntarily am giving my life. I voluntarily am going to die." He says, "I have the power to die. I give my life. I voluntarily lay it down. And I have the authority and the power to live again whenever I want." And I say, wow, that is awesome, okay? That's who Jesus is. And so Jesus can say something like this. Jesus can say, "I'm the way, the truth, and the life. And no one come to the Father except through me." Now, any nut could say that. Like looking, you know, in the back corner, you know, way back, you know, you in the red shirt, I can see you at the central sanctuary on the end. You're not a nut, but suppose you were. You could say, yes, it's you. You could say, "I'm the way and the truth and life. No one can come to the Father except through me." And we could all go, hmm. Jesus says it, and he says, "Let me back up my claim. Let me establish my claim. I'll do so by, you know what I'm going to do? I'm going to die, I'm going to be buried, I'm going to rise the 3rd day. Okay, let's see if anybody else did this. Our friend there, let's see. He hasn't died, buried, been raised again, but let's Google it. I love Google. How about you? I'm like this Google addict, you know, I get on a trail, and where did I start? I don't even know where I started in my search. And so we type it in, who else ever died, was buried, and rose again 3 days later, and search. And then it's like, oh man, it's been beyond 3 seconds. Like going through the whole world's knowledge and it takes 3 seconds. What does it matter? But it finally pops up. Who in the world other than Jesus Christ was dead, buried, and rose again 3 days later? Who? Nobody. Nobody. Entry after entry after entry after entry. Nobody. Jesus is the only one, and he backs up all his claims. He claimed to be God's son. He claimed to be able to give us peace. He claimed to be able to forgive you of all your sins. He claimed to be the only way to God. He claimed to be the only one who could fill the emptiness in your life and take away your guilt. He claimed to be able to give you eternal life. Jesus said, I am the resurrection and the life. Whoever believes in me will continue to go on living even if he dies. Some reacted by deriding the message. But secondly, we're told that others reacted by delaying. They delayed. They procrastinated. This was the attitude that some had when Paul preached that day in Athens. Some of them derided, some of them scorned, but others said in verse 32, we shall hear you again concerning this. Or as another translation more clearly says, we want to hear more about this later. Say later, later. We'll hear more about this later. They backtracked. Let's do this again sometime. Later. They delayed. They put the issue off. To them, the death and resurrection of Jesus Christ was interesting, but they put off doing anything about it. They feel like they should respond, I'm sure, but they decide to put it off for a more convenient time. You know, this is the reckless attitudes of millions of people today. They live by the motto, never do today what can be put off until tomorrow. You may put off making a decision for Christ until a more convenient time, but you're doing so at great risk. Did you know that in the history records, it was a telegraph operator on the ship California that tried repeatedly to get a message through to the telegraph operator on the Titanic. The telegraph operator on the Titanic wouldn't hear what the California ship operator was trying to tell him. He was saying, you need to be careful. There are icebergs in the area. You need to be careful. They're huge icebergs. Finally, the Titanic's operator, who was on the unsinkable ship, he got mad and wouldn't receive the warnings. And he indignantly replied, stop interfering. I'm busy. It was only a little while later that the side of the Titanic was ripped open by one of those icebergs, which could have been avoided had the warning been heeded. Could it be that God has sent you many, many warnings? How many times have you put off making a decision for Jesus? You've said later, I believe it. I'll talk about it later. I'll do something about it. I'm going to put this off. How many have just said, you know, God, stop interrupting. I'm busy. I'm busy with my life. Well, we can't bank on having a tomorrow. The Bible says, do not boast about tomorrow, for you do not know what a day may bring. The Bible says, how do you know what will happen tomorrow? For your life is like the morning fog. It's here a little while, and then it's gone. You know, I don't know how many times I have stood at the door, I've you know, moved around, shaking hands, because I love to see everybody. And I'm at the door and I'm shaking hands, and later in that week, midweek maybe, or a Thursday or a Friday, I get the message and I see the picture that one of those precious people I shook hands with has died. We had no idea. We're shaking a hand, we're giving a hug. I had no idea, they had no idea that we would never do that on earth again. See, we can't bank on tomorrow. I can't guarantee that you'll have another opportunity to place your faith in Jesus. I truly don't believe that most of us need more information about Jesus. I think most of us even understand the gospel that Jesus came to die for all the wrong things that we have done. I don't know that we need more information. I think it's a matter of stepping out of the delay stage, not procrastinate anymore, because I don't know if there'll be another opportunity. I don't know if there'll be another chance. And I believe that God has brought you here right now, not by accident, not by coincidence, but by a divine appointment. It's not a chance. You could be any other place. You could be hearing any other words. But God has you today. I mean, it's almost like, okay, your phone, your cell phone is off, but you feel the vibration. God is texting you right now. There's a text message for you, and he's saying, this is for you today. This is for you today. The message is up. You're hearing this right now because God has made a divine appointment with you. God is drawing you to his son, Jesus Christ. Augustine said, God has not promised tomorrow to your procrastination. Four times the Bible says, today if you hear his voice, do not harden your heart. Today if you hear his voice, do not harden your heart. Today, if you hear his voice, do not harden your hearts. And one more time, today, if you hear his voice, do not harden your hearts. God says he is ready to help you. The right time is now. Today is a day of salvation. In a few minutes, I'm going to give you the opportunity to accept Jesus, to make that decision and invite Jesus to come into your life and delay no longer. You see, some of the people, they derided the message. They mocked it. They scorned it. Others delayed. They knew it was right, but they had put it off for some reason. But others decided. They decided. We're told that some joined him and became believers. They believed. The resurrection of Jesus Christ from the dead proves that he is the Messiah. All his claims are true. He is the way, the truth, the life. No one can come to the Father except by him. You look at other religious leaders, they're all dead. The founders of all other religions, they're dead. Jesus Christ is alive. Historical fact. The Bible says that all of us have sinned. The Bible says that we've all fallen short of God's glorious perfection. We've all broken God's law. We've coveted. We've lied. Some of us may have stolen. Others of us may have dishonored our parents. The Bible says, honor your father and your mother. Some of us may have committed adultery. Thou shalt not commit adultery. Jesus expanded that, and he said, if you've ever had an immoral thought, you've already committed adultery. So bottom line, all of us are sinners. To sin means to miss the target. We've all sinned. And the Bible says the wages of sin is death. It's a high price to pay. But the gift of God is eternal life. You see, God can't just sweep sin under the carpet and say, ah, it's okay. No, sin is breaking the law, and when the law is broken, justice must be served. God is righteous. That is what makes him dependable. He's a righteous, holy judge. Yet also the Bible says God is love. So how does a holy, righteous judge deal with the wrong things we have done, and the wages of that is death, and yet also extend love to us? Well, the only way that can happen is if somebody becomes our substitute and takes the punishment we deserve. And that person dies in our place. And then we are able to step into their place. And that's exactly what God did. God devised this plan of salvation where Jesus came into the world. That's what Bethlehem is all about. He came into this world and he lived a perfect life. There was no one who could ever bring any accusation against him. Even Pilate, the Roman judge, when Jesus stood before him, said, "I find no fault in him." And he washed his hands of the whole deal, right? But why did Jesus go onto the cross? Jesus says, "No one forces me. I go voluntarily." Why did he march with that cross? Why did he set his face to Calvary and he decided, "I'm going to go all the way there. I'm letting the nails be nailed through my hands, the crown of thorns on my head, the nails in my feet. I'm allowing this to happen." Why? Because he is our substitute. He wanted to come and take the penalty of the wrong things that you've done. All the guilt that we have, Jesus had placed on him at the cross. That's why he cried out, my God, why have you forsaken me?" Those are the words that we should cry out. But we don't have to because he took our place. On the cross, he bore that crown of thorns we deserve. That crown of thorns, I look at that as the punishment for wrong thoughts. He had pure thoughts, but we have had dirty thoughts. Come on. In your honest moments, times when you wouldn't want anybody to see, he took that on himself. All that yuck was placed on him. His hands were nailed to the cross. His hands had never, ever done anything wrong. He'd never reached out to touch something he shouldn't have. All his hands did was bless, heal. He'd touch the lepers and heal them. Took the children in his arms, blessed them. His hands broke that bread and the miracle of feeding the 5,000. He took care of everyone's hunger. But our hands, a whole different story. We have reached out and we've taken things we shouldn't. Our hands have done things they shouldn't. Our hands have Googled things they shouldn't. He took the punishment we deserve. All of that was placed on him. And those feet nailed to the cross. Jesus said, "I always do the things that please the Father, and I always go where the Father wants me to go." He never went where he shouldn't go. But the Bible says, and we know, all of us have gone astray. There have been times when we have willfully walked away from what God wants us to do. But following that up, all of us have gone astray. It says, but God laid the iniquity, the sins of all of us on him. You see, Jesus came to be our substitute. Oh, and then that's that spear through his heart. Man, heart, he loved us perfectly. He loved God perfectly. Why was his heart broken? Well, he was taking, again, our place. We have loved wrong things. We have put a lot of things before God. And Jesus took that upon him as well. He is the perfect sacrifice. He did all this not to shame us. He took our shame even. He pays the guilt, but he also wants to take the shame so you don't have to have this dark cloud over your head. He took the shame on the cross too. He died naked on that cross, on a highway, people spitting on him, sneering at him. He had shame. He took your shame as well upon himself, so you don't have to be in shame anymore. He was cut off from God at that time so that you never have to be lonely. He will bring you into fellowship with himself. He took the guilt so you don't have to carry the guilt. He died so you don't have to die. And what death is separation from God, and you never will have to be separated from God if you believe, if you decide. You'll continue to go on living even if you die. You see, God made him, Jesus, who knew absolutely no sin at all. And he put all the sin of the world on him in order that those who believe in him can be credited with his perfect life. And that's how you get into heaven. You'll never get into heaven by being pretty good or very good, really nice or awesomely great. The only way you can get into heaven is through Jesus crediting his life to you. And then your life can start again. Some of you have got to set the reset. I was driving my van and my friend, I put gas in my van and I came in and he says, I hope you don't mind, but I reset your miles on your van. It started at zero again, not, you know, the shorter distance miles. I think, what an interesting figure of what Jesus can do for us. We can begin again. You can have a new start. The Bible says if any man or woman would be in Christ, be a new creation. The old things will pass away. Everything will become new. God is texting you right now. Some of us are definitely realizing, hey, God brought me here. Have you been reading my mail? God is texting you. You're feeling the Lord pulling you to himself. This is very real. What we're talking about is absolutely real. And this is the most important moment in your life. We take it very seriously. The Bible says today is a day of salvation. Today, if you hear his voice, don't harden your heart. Today, God will receive you. Oh, but I'm so bad. If you really knew what I did. Wait a minute, did you hear what I was saying earlier? But maybe you even need to hear more. Jesus says, whoever comes to me, I will never, ever, ever cast away. Whoever, that's not whoever accept. It's whoever comes to me, I'll never, ever cast away. No matter what you've done, Jesus says, all manner of sin, all kinds of sin, and even blasphemy, I'll forgive you. There's only one sin that can't be forgiven, gang, and none of you have committed it yet. And that sin is unpardonable, it can't be forgiven, and that is dying without deciding for Jesus. That sin cannot be forgiven. And God's giving you this opportunity right now to give your life to Jesus. He says, behold, I stand at the door and knock. If anyone hears my voice, that means he's also saying your name. If anyone hears my voice and will open the door, I will come in. And basically he says, I'll be his friend for life. Whoever calls on the name of the Lord will be saved, is what the Bible says. It's your moment now. How do you get saved? You call on God's name. You ask God to save you. That means praying. And so maybe you don't even know what to pray, how to pray. And so I'm going to lead you in a prayer in just a second. And we're going to ask that God would accept you. And you're going to offer God your life. And you will delay no more. You're deciding to follow Jesus. I want to pray for you right now. Would everybody please bow your heads and close your eyes? Father in heaven, I just thank you for what you're doing right now. I thank you for the work that you are doing in speaking to many hearts, drawing people to you, making this divine appointment happen and possible. And Lord, now I just pray that through faith, many will receive you. With our heads bowed and our eyes closed right now, I just want to speak to you for a second. You can have a brand new start. Your life can begin anew. This is what we'll do. I want you to pray with me a prayer where you call on the name of the Lord. Just a simple prayer. I want you to repeat after me. I'm going to pray it, and then you repeat after me. But I don't want you to say it out loud, okay? Just between you, me, and the Lord. But you mean it with all your heart, okay? Pray with me. Father in heaven, thank you for loving me and for sending Jesus to die for all the wrong things I have done. I'm sorry for my sins. I don't want to delay any longer. Please accept me. Forgive me. I give my life to you. I want to be a brand new creature. Please give me a new beginning. I accept you as my Savior and as my Lord. Please keep your heads bowed, your eyes closed. You prayed that prayer. I know you mean business with God. Jesus said, listen to what he says. He says, if you will acknowledge me before people, I will acknowledge you before my Father in heaven. But if you deny me before people, if you're ashamed of me before people, then I will not acknowledge you before my Father who is in heaven. This is what Jesus is saying. He's simply saying, you can't be ashamed of him. You can't be ashamed of him. You've made this decision to follow him. Everybody that Jesus ever called to be his disciple, he called them openly and publicly, and he said, come, get up and follow me. Jesus died on that cross, like I said, openly, publicly, taking our shame. Now, we can't, in these comfortable circumstances, be ashamed of him. You have more people praying for you right now than you've ever had in your whole life. Many of these people have been praying for weeks before this gathering for you. And now what I'm going to invite you to do is openly and publicly place your faith in Jesus. Wherever you're seated right now, whether you're at the central campus, the northwest, wherever you might be right now, what I want you to do is right now raise your hand. Everybody's praying for you. Their eyes are closed. Their heads are bowed. They're praying for you. You've made this decision for Jesus. Come on, raise your hands good and high. Raise your hands good and high. God bless you. I see you, and I see you. Please keep your hands up. I see you. And you, and you, and you, and you, and you, and you at the central campus. God bless you, and you. Please keep your hands up. I'll tell you why in a second. God bless you. Keep your hands up. God bless you here, up here. You in the middle. Some of you very young, some of you adults, raise your hands up good and high, please. In our overflow rooms, I want to pray for you. Keep your hands up. Father, you see our hands are up. Lord, you've said that when we believe in you, we become your children. And we have now the right to be called children of God. And we have our hands up because you also said that when we become your children, you will take us by the hand and you'll never let go of us. And so, Lord, it's as if right now we realize that you are grabbing us by the hand. You're never, ever going to let go of us. Okay, you can put your hands down now. Lord, I just pray that these many people who have made this decision will grow in you. They'll understand more deeply and fully the decision they've made in Jesus' name. Amen. Everybody, let's welcome you to the family of God. God bless you. So many of you all over the place. God bless you. You are a child of God, and you got a big family, and you've never had this many people clap for you in your whole life, have you? God bless you. Now, many of you received, those of you, I hope most of you who raised your hands, received a new believer's growth packet right here. We prepared it especially for you. Inside, there's a lot of great stuff to help you grow in your walk with the Lord. There's some more things to listen to. There's a new believer's handbook in here. Just a ton of stuff. Most important thing right now is there is a decision record that I want you to fill out in a few minutes. Give me your name and your contact info and decision that you've made for Jesus, because later on, I want to be able to contact you. It'll be through the mail. Hey, you'll get something in the mail. Because I know what has happened to you is going to be challenged. You heard it here. You're gonna encounter some opposition. You heard that here. Don't be dismayed by that. It's going to happen. And I'm going to send you some letters of encouragement over the next couple of weeks. Don't worry. The info will not be abused. I promise you it hasn't for 30 years since we've been doing this. It will encourage you and bless you. Okay? So that's very important to do. And now what we're going to do is I want us all to stand up. Please don't anybody exit yet. Let's all stand up, please. You made this decision for Jesus. And now what I want you to do is I want you to make it now very open and public. I don't want you to feel anxious. We'll turn down the lights, okay? But our doors to our prayer rooms are open. Please be patient with me as I help the Central Campus out here, because they've got so many things happening. Those of you in the Central Sanctuary, you see the doors opening to the south. Just go straight through those doors, because we want to pray for you and just fill out that record with you. Those of you who are in the North Sanctuary, just go straight back to the south. There'll be people who direct you the way to go. Okay, they're waiting for you. Those of you who are in the South Sanctuary, go right out the doors you came in, into the big atrium. There'll be people directing you where to go. Those of you who are in the chapel, there will be people there who will help you find your way up the sidewalk into the prayer room. So you're going to have a little walk. That's okay. Just think of how Jesus walked to the cross for you. He wasn't ashamed to do that. I want you to do the same thing. Here, it's easy. You just go up here to the north, up the steps into the prayer room. Pastor John is waiting right there, okay? So this is boldness. This is when you'll feel Velcro on your shoes. But this is like the boldest time, the best decision you've ever made, right, gang? Best decision you've ever made in your life. We are rooting for you. Oh, and by the way, the Bible says when one person gives their life to Jesus, the angels in heaven and God rejoice. Can you imagine the party in heaven right now? It's got to be awesome. And you're the reason for it. Okay, I want you guys to just go. Come on, you guys, make your way. Come on, just let people through the row. Let them get into the aisle. Let's give them a big hand. Give them a great big hand. Awesome.
Mountains, my awesome. God is mighty to save. He is mighty to save.
Forever. Let people through, okay?
Author of salvation.
Listen, if you came with somebody, they'll be happy to go with you, okay? Maybe there's somebody who's, you know, standing by you. They've got that packet, and you can tell they're kind of, I don't know what to do. Last night, several people said, hey, I'll walk with you to the prayer room. And those people went to the prayer room. Come on, let's go. Don't delay, all right? Go for it. Awesome, you guys. Let's keep our eyes on these on these folks. Let's encourage them, because at Central Campus, they got, some of them got a long walk, okay? So we just want to encourage them one more time. If you, listen, if you didn't raise your hand and you know God was speaking to you and you're thinking, oh, bummer, you know, I missed my chance. No, one more chorus, one more chorus. Can't guarantee you any more opportunities right now. Today, now is the day of salvation. Go for it. Okay, go for it. One last time. Campuses, now we're going to join together as Pastor David leads us in the most awesome song, the greatest song to be able to leave an Easter celebration with in the whole wide world. Let's sing it out with our whole heart. God bless you guys. Let's go.
Central Campus and Northwest Campus all together, I want us to join our voices. The simple message, Christ is risen. All right, we're going to sing it together. shine upon you. May the Lord be gracious to you and give you his countenance and his smile on you, and he will give you peace. Let's go out into this world. Let's tell those that we come in contact with that we worship the risen, the living Savior, Jesus Christ. Happy Easter.